Hey guys, this is Age of Mech and I'm going to show you the meta guide on how to play the Dili Sultanate. So no one really wanted to play these Dilis because they thought it seemed really weak, but then there was Vortix in the quarterfinals of the Genesis tourney and he pulled off a win against the French with the two Mosque opening. And now the Dili became meta. So in this video, I'm going to show you first strengths and the weaknesses of the civilization wheels quick. And then I'm going to show you the Vortix build order, go through the pros and cons of that. And then I'm going to show you an in-depth game plan on how to play the Dili Sultanate to its strengths until the castle age. And at lastly, I will go through the map pool and show you on which maps they are really good and on which maps they aren't. So to start off, in this meta, you want to go for the sacred sites first as the Dili Sultanate. This is because you have the sanctity tech in the mosque, which allows scholars to capture sacred sites before the castle age, and it generates 100% more gold. So if you start your build order and research it really quick, it will need about 4 minutes, and you will have at 4 minute 40, you can capture the first sacred site. Up until then, you will have like 20 to 22 villagers, and this gold will mean an extra 5 villagers. This is an insane boost. And you maybe can even capture a second sacred site. This is what the trick is about. But how are you able to compete for the sacred sites? And there comes the second tech in handy, the efficient production. It allows scholars to garrison in military buildings, boosting production speed by 100%. This means if you put a scholar in a military building, it will be built twice as fast and you will get your military units very, very fast on the field and can contest the sacred sites. What you should also keep in mind in early to mid feudal is your transitionings are insanely fast. So let's say you're in an archer war and normally you don't really want to go for horsemen because two or three horsemen won't really cut the deal. They get kited and they just die and they aren't really a good meat shield. But with the Dili Sultanate, you can go one stable and instead you don't have 3 horsemen, but you will have 6 horsemen in that time period. So you can really catch your enemy off guard. So these are the main advantages of the Dili. Then there's this special thing with the Dili. You don't have to pay resources for upgrades. So in the blacksmith, you see 4 minutes it takes to research something. That's an advantage because you don't pay resources, and in late game, like Imperial Age, one upgrade will cost, like, for example, mostly 1,000 resources, and you get them for free. So late game, this is really, really good as a bonus. But there's a big disadvantage in early game. Let's say you go for Archer War, you really want to have your Iron Undermesh, the ranged armor, very quickly, or the ranged damage. And you won't be able to do that. Also, your transitioning to melee, for example, won't be really quick. Plus, if you want to go for ram push, you have to really need it beforehand. That makes it quite difficult. So in order to prevent that, to make it not the biggest disadvantage, you can go for a second blacksmith or you fill the mosque with scholars. So if you go to the second age, you get the landmark to build, to produce scholars for half the price. And you really, really, really want to produce them. Like a town center, for example. You want to produce villagers constantly and scholars constantly. Because every scholar will reduce the time of the research about 20%. So let's say you go for one mosque. Full, it's only from 4 minutes to 247. Two mosques, it's from 247 to 136. And don't be shy to get the third mosque if you have the resources for it, because then you will get down to 1 minute. And it was 5 minutes before, so that's insanely good. Don't sleep on the fact that you can get your upgrades quite fast. One more advantage of the Dili Sultanate is the forced march bonus. It makes your infantry move 100% faster, so if you spam man-at-arms in Castle Age and the enemy will go for springles in this meta, you can catch him and kill a lot of springles, except Mongol springles, because they are too fast to get even with this bonus. All right, these are the basic advantages and disadvantages. So now I'm going to show you the Vortex build order and then go through a game plan on how to play them. So what you want to do is you want to go for either the two mosque opening or one mosque opening. I will start with the two mosque opening. So you go for the berries first, then a mosque, then a house, then back to the berries. You want to go for a mill because, first of all, the dealies gather berries faster. Plus, you can instantly research attack for free. So you can research wheelbarrow for free, and that's really, really good. Then the next free villager will go on wood, because you want to get the second mosque as fast as possible. If you have the mosque up, you want to go for sanctity first, so you can instantly research, instantly capture sacred sites. So this one who builds the mosque at the house will go back to the berries. Then you will get 3 on wood, and then the 7th back on the berries, so you can get up to feudal age quickly. So the two mosque opening will delay your feudal age time by about 30 seconds. So keep that in mind, that sometimes against the Mongols or against the English players, you don't really maybe not wanna open two mosque, because if you have longbows in your base, it's really difficult to defend. But with that in mind, you might go for an outpost or just go for one mosque and for the efficient military production fast. So you build the second mosque, and then the next villager after the food goes to gold. Where's the gold? So this is a really tight build. So normally when you go to the gold, you will have 50 wood exactly as he's finished, and he might will go back to the town center. So you really have to keep in mind that he might wander back to the town center and you have to stop him. You see he has 8, 9, he has 10 gold. He wants to go back, and now the wood comes in for the mining camp. So this build is really, really tight. The third villager will go on gold as well. And now comes the second tight thing. The rest will go on wood until you move up. You see the wood, the tree will only have exactly the amount you need for a lumber camp. So what the villagers will do is they get the lumber camp done, and then they want to go to the next regular tree. What you have to do instead is you have to collect the resources on your town center and then build a lumber camp with them. It seems a little tricky, but it is quite easy to master, to be honest. So if you have the second mosque, I forgot, you want to go for efficient production as fast as possible, obviously, and then your build is done. You see, I have 390 food, the gold will come in, and he took 3 of his wood to go up in the next age. I'm just a little slow. I should be a little faster, but you will be up about at like 310 to 315. You go for the Dome of Faith because it produces scholars cheaply and you really want those scholars. So I don't have the timeline open. Let's see if I can open it really quick. Oops, if you see the game duration, you will see, I haven't done it really. But when you see the research tag, sanctity will be up in about 50 seconds. So what you want to do is, if you have 25 seconds or so left, you want to go to the first sacred site. With that in mind, sometimes the enemy scout will attack your scholar, or a wolf will attack the scholar. So you should always take a scout with you to the first sacred site. What you can additionally do is to take a villager with you and build an early outpost. So with the early outpost, you have two big advantages. First, it's an outpost. This is great as well. But second of all, you will have additional possibilities. Let's say you go for the first sacred site, put a tower here, and then the field will get a little scrappy. You go for the second sacred site and your army will be smaller. You have like three archers here, two horsemen here, and the enemy might go to attack you on 2 points as well. So if you have, for example, three horsemen here, and he comes with spearmen, you have to give up the sacred site. But if you have the tower, you can put your spearmen in there, and they efficiently counter horsemen. So this tower allows you to counter the enemy even with the wrong units. So I really recommend you to go for an early tower, especially on the first sacred site. Then as you go up, you decide on which military you go for. Let's go, for example, for the... Oh. Enemy is really aggressive, but I can just hear. Nice trade. So you go for the first sacred site. You might be fast enough. Then you go for the second. And you see the efficient production research is nearly done. So you can go for the... Or the production boost on a military building. So what you want to do next is you pump out military buildings. You got the first sacred site with the outpost. And the second trick is I will always go for the furthest outpost. This isn't the furthest, but I normally go for the furthest outpost. And with your archer or spearman, you can wall it. So, for example, you wall the sacred site and the enemy will have a hard time. I'm just randomly doing it right now. Yeah, there's a woodline. And if the enemy sends in like two or three horsemen, he won't really be able to capture this sacred site. And this is huge because it's furthest away. And if he really tries to get through the walls, you can take the other sacred sites or pressure him in his base. So keep in mind that your infantry can wall, and this is very, very good. So after you played this early game with the two sacred sites, you have to really decide on what your next game plan will be. Because yet now comes the big disadvantage of the daily. The big disadvantage is your late feud age. So you really want to fight for the sacred sites, but afterwards, in my opinion, in late feudal age, you have to give up the sacred sites to go into castle age. Because you will have a lot of gold that you can't really spend. The only way you can spend your gold is with scholars, but you don't really have gold units in feudal age, and you can't use it for research because it's for free. So most of the times you will have to get, or you want to have to get the market up to balance out your eco. Plus you wanna go to Castle Age to spend that gold. The biggest problem about late feudal age is, in my opinion, you can't really research your techs fast enough, your blacksmith techs. So the enemy will always have a tech advantage against you. And this is a huge problem. Even if you have a lot of scholars in there and the second blacksmith, you will be later than him. So in my opinion, it is good to lose the sacred sites in the late feudal age and recapture them later. All right, this is mostly the game plan, how I win most of the games. You start with the tower, go for the walls, go for a lot of unit production, and then you transition into Castle Age with your extra resources. The biggest advantage is why you can transition to Castle Age is if you play another civilization and he goes for a feudal push, you might just die in your base because you have the ramp push and you're going to Castle Age. But with the Dili Sultanate, they will go for the sacred site, they will go for the tower, they might go for the walls, and then they deny you your sacred sites, but they don't get an advantage. and you will have 1 or 2 extra minutes until they are at your base. And these 2 minutes will let you get to Castle Age and then pump out fast man-at-arms or lancers or whatever you want, even fast springouts, because you can build scholars, you can put the scholars inside them. So this is for sure the main game plan on how to play the Delhi Sultanate, and this is the most success I have with them. And if you reach the late game, well, there are good late game civilization with the free researchers. All right, this was a little bit messy, I'm sorry. Now I'm going through the maps to show you on which map they are good and on which map they aren't. So on Dry Arabia, Lipany, Highview, they are quite decent. These are all mediocre maps. Mountain Pass is a little special because you will have one sacred site on your side that is really easy to obtain, and you will have it. And if it's possible, you can try to deny the enemy the walls and go for the second sacred site and fight for it. This would be the optimal scenario, because you have one for free and fight for the second, but at least you will always get one for free. So this map is decent. Ancient Spires might not look too good because this is more of a hybrid map, but I had a lot of success with the early aggression build, because you can deny the dogs with early aggression, plus the gold of the sacred sites will compensate for missing dogs. And you might even want to go for your own dogs. So this map is quite decent as well. The Nuba River is lucky or unlucky, depends on it, because there's a river in the middle and 2 sacred sites has to be on one side. So if you're lucky, you have 2 sacred sites on your side and can protect them quite easily or more easily, but the enemy will have 2 sacred sites and it will be harder for you to get to them. Black Forest isn't really the greatest map. Yes, you can go to your sacred sites fast and they are really easy to defend, but this is quite the boomy map with water and the Chinese and walling and stuff. So this map is not the greatest. So I haven't had the greatest success on this map. Mongolian Heights, we saw the Delhi playing there on the Genesis tournament and lose. I think this map is quite bad for them, because 1 sacred site is on your side, but there's only a 2nd sacred site on the other side that you nearly never will be able to obtain. And there's water in the middle, so you might have to go for early aggression or a dock and can't really go for a 2 mosque opening. So this map is, in my opinion, not the greatest. Altai is a great, great map for the Delhis, because the sacred sites are on the side and very easy to wall. What you want to do is get the sacred sites early, wall it up with your infantry, and then go for a mid push. If the enemy wants to contest the sites, you can just go for the middle and try to attack his base. So Altai is a really, really good map for the Delhi, in my opinion. Confluence is in theory pretty decent, because you have 4 sacred sites, so it's more likely that you have 2 plus sacred sites, plus the late game with the Delhi is quite decent as well. The French Pass is really, really good again, in my opinion, because both sacred sites are in the middle, and if you get to 1 sacred site, you most likely have 2, because they are so easy to wall off. So it's 2 or none, and this makes the civilization very good on this map, in my opinion. Lente is quite decent. King of the Hill is very special because it has only 1 sacred site, and this sacred site, 1 sacred site might be too little as a bonus to have for the Delhis. Plus, on the King of the Hill, there are no straggler trees, so you can't really start with the 2 mosque opening that easily. Island maps aren't obviously good, they are not the French. Nagari, I don't really have that much sample size on Nagari, because I don't really play them on this map, so you will have to find it out by yourself. Yeah, this was my first guide, so I hope you enjoyed it. It wasn't too bad, and if you want to support me, I'm really happy if you like it, or give me a follow on Twitch. Goodbye.